A bookstore in six chapters. The story of Solomon and René Molho. Chapter 1. There was once a world. Thessaloniki, or Salonika as it was once called, is an ancient city. Our history goes back more than 2,000 years. So, when we speak of the Molho bookstore, which lasted a little more than a century, from 1888 to 2004, it's not a very long time, although it did last longer than any other bookstore. Back in the day, the Molho bookstore was something special. It's where you came to find books in Greek and English, French and German. The store was owned by René Saltiel Molho and Solon Molho. Solon and René had been born in Salonika early in the 20th century, when there were nearly 90,000 Jews in the city. Since the Second World War, they have been barely more than 1,000. Like so many Jewish survivors of the Holocaust, Solon and René never wanted to speak about all they had lost. It hurt too much. Solon died in 1997, never having spoken about the lost world of Salonika's Jews. As for René, well, she did share her story not long before she died in 2008. She told it to me, her daughter Nina. And so it won't be lost. I'll share the story with you. Chapter 2. The world we found, the world we made. Jews lived in Salonika from the time the city was founded in the period of Alexander, 300 years before Jesus. In fact, the Apostle Paul preached in one of the synagogues here. For the next 1,500 years, Jews lived through all of Salonika's history. In the 15th century, Salonika became part of the Ottoman Empire, and in 1492, Jews expelled from Spain began arriving. By 1519, Jews were around half the population of Salonika, and it remained that way for centuries. Jews, Christians, and Muslims living together all over the Balkan Peninsula. In fact, according to the Ottoman law, families held Turkish, Greek, Spanish, Italian, French, and other passports depending on their family's origins. This multi-ethnic city is where Isaac Molho opened his first bookshop in 1888 on Sabri Pasha Street. And this period lasted until the early years of the 20th century. Then, in 1912, in the First Balkan War, Salonika became part of modern Greece. The Molho family had new Greek passports. The Saltiels kept their Spanish passport, but both families were proud citizens of Salonika and Greek patrons. History was now changing faster than you could imagine. First came the Great Fire of Salonika in 1917, which destroyed half of the city and the first Molho bookstore. And 50,000 Jews were made homeless. Then, in 1923, there was a massive population exchange with Turkey. Muslims were sent from their homes in Greece to Turkey. Christians from Turkey, especially Izmir, were sent to Salonika and other Greek cities. Jews were no longer the majority in Salonika now, and the atmosphere in the city had changed dramatically. On the 29th of June 1931, for the first time in its history, there were anti-Semitic riots in Salonika. Over the next years, 30,000 Jews emigrated. That left 56,000 Jews in Salonika on April 9, 1941, the day the Germans arrived. Chapter 3. Esta chica es para ti. This is the girl for you. This is Mair Molcho and his wife Sterina Herrera Molcho, and they lived in a large house on Mizrahi Street. They had two daughters, Yvonne and Victoria, and a son, Solon, or Solomon, who was born in November 1918. Solon was a natural salesman. He sold his first book when he was 7. But he loved sports. He loved camping, sailing, and skiing. One thing is for sure. Both Mair and Solon loved books, reading them, talking about them, and selling them. Joseph Saltiel, a lumber dealer, and his wife Stella Bravanel Saltiel lived a few streets away. They had three beautiful daughters, Mathilde, René, and Edda. Back then, on Saturday afternoons, lots of families in Salonika would go for walks by the seashore. And whenever Sterina Molcho saw the three Saltiel girls, she would nod towards René and say to her son Solon, "Esta es la chica para ti." René was an excellent student. She graduated from the Alliance Française Universelle and then went to the American school, the Anatolia College. René had her own friends, her social life too. The Molcho and the Saltiels were typical Balkan Sephardic Jews, traditional but not terribly religious. You see, to be Jewish in Salonika back then was not like being Jewish in a big German city or in Poland or anywhere else. You wanted to go to the synagogue, you had 100 to choose from. You wanted the Jewish newspaper? There were more than 40, and 35 of them were in Ladino. They had youth clubs and boxing clubs, Jewish hospital, and old age homes, religious schools, and secular Jewish schools that taught in Greek or in French. At the edge of the town, there was the largest Jewish cemetery in the entire world. It dated back to the Roman times, with 350,000 graves. That is more than the great Jewish cemeteries of Warsaw and Berlin combined. Chapter 4. When the world went dark. On the 28th of October 1940, when the Italian fascists invaded Greece, Solon and more than 12,000 other Greek Jews defended their country. Our armies held off the Italians for half a year. In view of the upcoming invasion of the Germans in Greece, Solon was instructed by his commanding officer to depart on foot and deliver the unit's cash to the Greek military authorities. He arrived to Salonika after the Germans that had already invaded Greece and occupied the city on the 9th of April 1941. At first, no one was sure what would happen. But the signs were not good, and in December 1941, Mair Molcho was forced to sell his bookstore to a Greek man, a Nazi collaborator, basically for nothing. Here is one of the papers from the time the store was confiscated. They even took away the name. One Saturday morning, on the 11th of July 1942, Jewish men were ordered to gather in the Freedom Square in the center of the town. thousands came and registered. They were treated brutally, not only by the SS, but by regular Wehrmacht soldiers. There were even some local collaborators. They stood there in the biting sun of the summer the whole day, and after that came the first labor brigades. From the summer 1942 until spring the next year, everything got worse and worse for Jews. The community had to give up all its money to the German authorities. Jews had to turn in their radios. They lost their jobs. Things were so bad that when René's mother, Sterina, had an appendix operation in January 1943, she died because they couldn't get proper medicine to treat her. The Wehrmacht administrator, Marx Merten, in collaboration with the Greek administrator the Germans installed, Vasilis Simonidis, had the city employees destroy the Jewish cemetery. Then Dr. Merten, along with Dieter Wislenseni and Alois Brunner of the SS, turned their attention to those Jews not yet in the cemetery. First, in February 1943, Jews were forced to wear the yellow star. Then Germans forced the Jews into 5 ghettos in February 1943. Even the hundred of Jews, like the Saltiels, who had Spanish passports. It was then that Solon Molcho made his escape. He came to say goodbye to René, then sailed away from Salonika. The Jews of Salonika were then transferred to the Baron Hirsch ghetto near the train yard. This first transport began taking away the Jews on the 15th of March 1943. The story of Meir Molcho, the great bookstore owner, came to an end when he was deported with his wife Sterina and one of their daughters, Yvonne, and her family. The deportations continued all the way until August. Most of them were headed for the gas chambers of Auschwitz-Birkenau. So very, very few came back. Chapter 5, Escape. Solon Molcho's sister Victoria was married to Yuda Leon, who manufactured soap, and one of the ingredients of his soap was olive oil. Yuda's olive oil came from the village of Glossa on the island of Skopelos, and it was provided by Yorgos Mintziliotis and Stefanis Korfiatis. As conditions in Salonika were deteriorating, Yorgos sent a message asking them to come to Glossa. Following a series of adventures, Yuda and Victoria and their children arrived in Athens, where they joined Solon. And Yorgos managed to come with a boat to pick them up. This is how gradually Yorgos managed to collect the whole Leon family, 14 persons in total, and hid them with the help of all the people of the village until the end of the war. Yorgos Mintziliotis and Stefanis Korfiatis with their wives were all given awards for being righteous among the nations by Israel's Holocaust Museum Yad Vashem. The survival of my mother's family was a far more complicated story. After her mother died, René and her sisters, Edda and Mathilde, realized their father Joseph had cancer. They had their Spanish passports, and they, like other Spanish Jews, waited to know their fates. But a man in the Italian consulate, by the name of Neri, helped the sister and the father escape from Salonika to Athens just before the Jews were deported. The four of them arrived in Athens in August 1943. They lived in different places to avoid detection, and finally on Bubulina Street, a woman by the name of Litsa Lembesi looked after them. In April 1944, an informer told the Germans where they were hiding. And on the 7th of April, German soldiers broke into the apartment and took Edda and Matilde to the Gestapo and then to the infamous Haidari concentration camp, where prisoners were being shot every week. They saw that Joseph was near death, and they told René, "We will come back for you in a few days." 13 days later, Joseph Saltiel died, and Mrs. Lebesi told René to get out of the flat and go stay in her apartment. And the Germans arrived looking for René that very night. Mrs. Lebesi contacted a Spanish diplomat, Sebastián Romero Radigales. He had already given René some money to help the family to survive. Now, he made sure that Joseph Saltiel was buried in the Jewish section of the Athens cemetery, and he paid for the burial and the tombstone. Then Mrs. Lebesi went to the Haidari prison, a concentration camp, to visit Edda and Matilde and bring them food and clothing Mr. Romero Radigales gave to her. My mother never forgot the kindness of Mrs. Lebesi. Here is a picture of her with my father when she received the Righteous Gentile Award from the Yad Vashem. René, all alone now, was desperate to escape, and Romero Radigales gave her Spanish travel papers. Over the next few weeks, with the help of the resistance, René escaped by lorry and by boat all the way to Turkey, and then, on the 6th of June 1944, she arrived by car in British Mandate, Palestine. In little more than a year, René Saltiel had lost both her parents, watched the Jews of Salonika being taken away to their death, traveled to Athens under the eyes of the Nazis, had watched her sisters being arrested by Germans, was saved by a woman she had never met, and had made a dramatic escape by train, by truck, by walking, by ship, and by car. Finally safe in Tel Aviv, she waited for the war to end and prayed for the good news from her sisters and Solon. In October 1944, the Germans abandoned Greece and headed north. The news came to René in Tel Aviv, and she heard that both Edda and Matilde had survived and were living in Athens. After liberation, Solon returned to Salonika and immediately reclaimed his bookshop, and for a while the British intelligence service used it too. After that, Solon had another piece of business to settle. He sent a telegram to Tel Aviv and asked if René would marry him. And this is what he wrote to her.
Reçu nouvel consentement. Immense bonheur. Espère reconstituerons ensemble merveilleux avenir. Attends impatiemment retour. Avec tout mon amour. Salomon.
On the 25th of October 1945, she sailed from Haifa. Arriving home in Salonika, she found Solon recovering in a hospital from a hernia operation. She ran to him and they burst into tears. I will never forget how René described that first meeting. First you cry, later you laugh. You don't think. On the 17th of March 1946, René Saltiel became Mrs. Solon Molcho. It was a miracle they had both survived and they would spend the rest of their lives together. Chapter 6. A World of Books, Words Never Said. Solon and René's son Meir, my brother, was the first Jewish boy born in Salonika after the war. Then came Joseph, and then me. Solon and René dedicated themselves to their store. The universities bought from them, and they stocked the best literary publications in the world. They never stopped working. They were in love with their store, in love with literature, and in love with each other. Some of the greatest writers in the world came and gave lectures in the Molcho bookstore, like Umberto Eco and Harold Pinter, who won the Nobel Prize of Literature. In 1988, the French ambassador bestowed on them the Chevalier des Arts et des Lettres. As for the family René and Solon started, we have blossomed with our own children and grandchildren. Our Jewish community is tiny compared to what it was once, but we rebuilt every institution we could. But as you can imagine, Salonika for us is, as an historian calls it, a city of ghosts. The largest Jewish cemetery in the world. Today a university stands on its ruins, and there isn't even a plaque to commemorate it. Solon Molcho died in 1997, and his bookshop did not have long to live either. You see, the world is not kind to grand old bookstores like ours, where clerks love their books and know just what to recommend for you and just for you. The Molcho bookstore closed its doors in 2004. In her last years, René Saltiel Molcho was devoted to her grandchildren, and we, her children, were devoted to her. I would take her to the new Jewish cemetery of Salonika, where my mother would visit the memorial of all those taken away and murdered. Then she would stand before this grave and that one and spend time before each one. She would then stand at the grave of her husband and have a little chat with him, knowing that someday soon he would welcome her again. Religious? No, my mother wasn't religious, and she only went to synagogue on happy occasions, and we gave her many of them. I only know that once a year on Yom Kippur, the Jewish Day of Atonement, Solon Molcho and René Saltiel Molcho would sit in the living room of our house, and we children were told to play very quietly. And for the entire day, they sat there in the dark and closed themselves off to the noisy city of Thessaloniki, once the largest Sephardic Jewish community in the world, that had grown up all around them, and now lives without their bookshop and without them.
Thank you.